Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Very good afternoon and welcome back to the chemistry class. So after your last assessment, as some of you also have suggested, and I think it's a good suggestion that you wanted again to revise back periodic table so that you can understand it very well. So fine, that's good. So today's class is only to take you back to the periodic table and explain it again in detail so that you understand chemical bounding properly, and then we'll go back to chemical bounding. And after this, again, you'll have an assessment. On based on that, we have to understand how much you understood periodic table also. And but I'm happy with your assessments. Most of you, they were majority were just average. They got 50% marks. That is the reason we wanted to revise it again. And there were some very good students also who could do it well. Then I'm happy with the way Malik is going. He's even started balancing the equations, showing so much of interest. So hope we make periodic table also very interesting. So let's start with periodic table. Right, so if you look at, as I told you, there is a need to have always a systematic study to understand how, you know, the elements are connected, they are arranged. So if you can take an example of, a medical shop, just to take you back to the imaginations. Think of it as an icebreaker. What happens if you go to a medical shop and you want medicines? So there are vast number of medicines that are present in the medical shop, but how is it possible that the shopkeeper gives you immediately, you give a receipt and he takes out, he knows where that particular medicine is kept. So how is it possible? It's not possible until and unless he arranges them in that order. He will know that which particular, like paracetamols are in a different cabinet, variety of paracetamols are in one place, or, you know, there are cold medicines are in some other place, cough medicines are kept in some other place, BP, diabetes, whatever it is, the different diseases, neurological diseases, all that has got its own particular place from where he could take it out. And that is the reason, you know, it becomes very easy for a medical shopkeeper to give you medicines. So similarly, even scientists, it was becoming very difficult for the scientists because they did understood the importance of elements. As you all know, somebody made a mistake while doing it, that carbon is present. Carbon is an element that is present in all living forms. Okay, there was an option which was given to you in MCQs where water, air, and plants and clothes, where carbon is not present. So carbon is not present only in clothes, and in all the places you'll find there is no element, no place where there is no carbon. So when these scientists understood the importance of elements and what not they can do, people can become millionaire and billionaire if they are able to identify these elements. If you see, Kalpana Chawla gave her life. Why did she want to go to the space? She wanted to find out if there is a medicine for cancer, that she can get some elements or something from there, you know. And they particularly, the scientists were not only for earning money, they are doing it. They are even making our life, simplifying our life. Okay, that is the reason a science lover is also a very good human being, because you think about the, until and unless you are not thinking about destructing the environment, as long as you think that how can I keep my earth green and the sky blue and serve the people, then you know you can do tremendous changes you can bring into this world. So Robert Boyle in 1661, imagine it was in 1661, that is 400 years ago, he defined that elements or the substance are decomposed, cannot be decomposed, you know. An element is the smallest particle, you cannot further decompose it into any smaller substance than existing one, either through a physical force or through a chemical change. It's impossible. So Robert has found it out in 1661, somewhere 400 years back. And at this time, only 13. at the time when he was talking about this, he has given this definition, there are only 13 elements that were discovered. Okay, so you just imagine with those 13 elements, those 13 elements itself were so precious because they can combine, form different forms of compounds, molecules. But once this combination is happening, we don't know which one is a good combination and which one is a not a good combination, useful combination. Like, for example, nowadays there are so many of theories that are coming out when you are eating food also, which when it gets breakdown, if you are eating wrong type of two different types of foods, that may become poisonous also for you. Some becomes beneficial. So usually it is said that when you are taking, you know, vitamin C along with iron, it's a very good absorbent, and that's how you can get iron into your body. So this iron again is an element that is found in the atmosphere. So these 13 elements that were formed, were known at that time, were towards the end of, then what happens, you just imagine, 16th century, 16 to 18th century, for 200 more years, there were no more than 11 elements discovered, only 11 elements. So how much time it has taken, you can just imagine, to discover all new elements. Then towards the end of 18th century, Lavoisier has discovered 11 more elements. Okay, so now there were around 23 elements and they were synthesized and were obtained. So how did these 11 were also not natural. They were synthesized, they were made by human being. So that's how now 23 elements were discovered or invented, we can say, because if it is made, we can even call it as invention. So now including these synthetic elements, there are 115. So right now there are 115 elements and more. You can even further, you know, there is so much of scope to go for inventing or discovering many more elements which we are not knowing it. Only 115 elements have made so much of you know, this thing in the world. Hazard's atomic bomb has been discovered. There were many good, you know, inventions have also happened. If you can just see, a small mercury was used to for so many purposes, you know, it has got its own benefits as well as the destructive. The way how a person can use science is very important. So that is where is important, is your moral education, and along with this education you understand your responsibility, sense of responsibility, because we are human beings, we are not animals. So whatever we have to do is, we have to do for the benefit of this world. So now if you are including, as the number of elements increases, it becomes difficult to keep in memory the chemistries of individual elements and their compounds. You know, every element has got its own properties. Its own properties in the sense is characteristics. Like as a human being, every individual human being has got its own peculiar characteristics. So are the elements. But imagine 115 elements. Now in your class of 35 students also, it's very difficult for me to remember which child, you know, I had to keep a data in recorded in a systematic manner, organized in a systematic manner. And thanks to the technology, because of the Google Forms, I am able to know where my students are, how many percentage of my students could not understand this concept, and I have to repeat back the periodic table. So all this data was necessary, is very much necessary for teaching also. So similarly in these elements, also we have to, you cannot memorize and keep things, that has requires a systematic organization of the elements. So the number of elements, when it becomes increasing, then it was very difficult. When there were 13 elements, also memorizing and keeping, remembering about the elements, you just imagine, if you have to learn about the properties of hydrogen by heart, the properties of hydrogen, helium, neon, chlorine, fluorine, goes on, and 115 elements, will it be easy for you to do that? It's very difficult. So now the scientists started thinking, how can we keep these elements, classify them in a way that one string, if you have got one group or one period, you should be able to understand the entire string or the entire row and group column. In a column or in a row, how they are arranged, you will be able to understand its physical and chemical properties or characteristics of that element. So that's how all the scientists, they started thinking of organizing them into a fundamental table, in a sort of a table, so that it becomes easier for us to understand. So in 18th century, again, Joseph Lewis, he stated that hydrogen atom is the building material and atom of all other elements. So according to him, he said that hydrogen is one basic element, you know, that forms all the other elements or compounds. That was his hypothesis. Okay, but how far he could prove it, or he failed in doing it, he could make us all understand that hydrogen atom is a building material and atoms of all, for every element, he said that no other element can exist without hydrogen. So hydrogen is due to its combining capacity. That is what was Lewis' idea about, his hypothesis, I should say. At Lewis Prost's time, the atomic weight of all elements were given as whole numbers, and the atomic weight of hydrogen was taken as one. So at that time, you know, they were not. Now, you know, the atomic weight, even you will get it in digits also. But at that time, Lewis has made it as a whole number atomic weight, and the atomic weight of hydrogen was one. So he was saying that in every element or any compound, anything that is formed, it has to take hydrogen. Without that, it cannot be formed. Then Debonair came up with the triads theory, but that Lewis theory failed because he could not prove it. It was his hypothesis, but he could not prove it. Then a German chemist by name Debonair, in 1829, he noted down, according to him, there was a series. He was saying that every two or three elements has got, you know, they repeat their characteristics after three. If you can just see, he said that lithium, sodium, and potassium, these three elements makes a triad, three elements triad, and they have got the similar chemical properties. Right. And he tried to give a relationship between the properties of the elements and their atomic weight. That is how he has designed. If you can just see lithium, sodium and potassium, its atomic weight of lithium is 7 and sodium is 23 and potassium is 39. And similarly, he showed that if you look at the elements like calcium, selenium and barium, it is 40, 88 and 137. And similarly, chlorine, bromine and iodine, 35.5, 80 and 127. So according to him, he said that a periodic table should be arranged in the ascending order of their atomic weights. So he thought of making a periodic table using the atomic weight as the basis. And he said that these elements, which are having similar atomic weight, will have the same chemical properties. And Debonair stated that when elements with the similar properties are taken three at a time and arranged in an ascending order of their atomic weight, they exhibit same properties. So it will become very easy for you to understand, you know, lithium, sodium. And so what he was saying is, and the element that is in between, like if you see sodium, selenium and bromine, these are the central elements. And if it was calculated, the average weight of all the three elements was the weight of the central element. That is how Debonair was trying to justify his hypothesis. This statement is called as the Debonair law of triads. Okay, so this is Debonair's triads law. For that, you know, let's do an activity to see what do we observe in this table. If you see lithium, sodium and potassium, so lithium and sodium, lithium is 7, okay, and potassium is 39.2, and if you divide it by 2, it gives you the atomic weight of sodium, that is 23. And similarly here, if you see calcium is 40, barium is 137, and if you divide it by 2, 88.5 is the atomic weight of should be the strontium. Atomic weight of strontium should be 88.5. But what do we find here? It's 87.5. And then chlorine and iodine. And when we saw the average weight of bromine should be 81.25, but we have found it as 80. And sulfur and tellurium, their average is 78.5. And whereas selenium's atomic weight is 78. And magnesium and iron, 55 plus 56, the average should be 55.5. But chromium's, when we weighted it, that is what we do in the science experiments. You just don't have to believe in the data until unless you measure it. Everything has to be measurable. But when we were measuring, it should have been 55.5, but it was found to be 52. So Debonair attempt gave a clue that atomic mass could be correlated with the properties of the elements. Then, but his theory has got its own limitations. So what are the limitations of his theory? If you see the elements at the end, the law failed for very low mass or very high mass of elements. Anyhow, you know, when he was saying that the central element should have a weight of average weight, in 55.5, it was 52. So some extent, he could, you know, you can round about and say that it's nearing approximate weight we can talk about. But this theory completely failed with the elements which has got very low and high atomic weight. There, that was the limitation of his hypothesis. In case if you take fluorine, chlorine, bromine, the atomic weight of chlorine is not an arithmetic mean of the atomic weight of fluorine and bromine, isn't it? If you see, bromine should be 81.25 if Debonair's theory has to be accepted, but it was found to be 80. So the hypothesis is rejected here. So Debonair's hypothesis was not valid, and it could not satisfy, it could not remain strictly valid for all the elements, because a system has to be, it should have been generalized, and that law failed. Then Newland started. John Newland was a British scientist who in 1865, he arranged all the elements in ascending order of their atomic weights. They appear to fall in 7 groups. So what he did is, he just simply, you know, to make it very easy for us to understand the properties, he said that let us go for, according to the weights of the elements, let us arrange them according to the weights of the element. And he arranged them into 7 groups, all the elements. And each group contained an element with similar chemical properties, and all that is how, based on these observations, Newland proposed the law of octaves. So Newland's law of octaves were very interesting, but again, you know, it could not, this law, octaves law, also had got some limitations. The law of octaves state that when elements are arranged in ascending order and their atomic weights fall into a pattern in which their properties repeat at regular intervals. So according to him, octaves, what he said is octagon, pentagon, you know, octa means 8. So according to him, 8 elements, like if you see hydrogen, lithium, gallium, I think he kept here, boron, carbon, nitrogen and oxygen, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That is F. Now, if you see, fluorine is kept here. So this 8th element, hydrogen and fluorine, they repeat their properties. So every 8 elements, and then chlorine comes to be the 8th element. Then cobalt and nickel and bromine. Then lead, PD is lead, and its Greek or Latin name must be podium. What it is, I don't know. So this is how must be, but we call it lead. So PD is lead, I is iodine. So that is what, you know, here you get a lot of confusion because these are all Greek and Latin element names. So you have to try and revise it all. They were arranged. So this is what his, according to him, after every 8 elements, there is a regular change, and the properties are same. So that is the reason it became an octave theory. That is, this octave theory became very popular. And it was interesting because he could, to a greater extent, he could arrange the elements with which were having similar properties, starting from hydrogen onwards. And these elements with similar chemical properties are presented along an horizontal row. So according to Newland's table, if we start with hydrogen and move down and then start at the top of eighth element, it's fluorine. And next eighth element is chlorine and so on, as I told you. So first hydrogen, then eighth was fluorine, then chlorine. And so these, all these elements horizontally should have the same properties if if his theory has to be, octave theory has to be, hypothesis has to be accepted. But similarly, if you start at lithium, then the eighth element is sodium and next coming element is potassium and so on. So now this second series should also be there. These elements show similar physical and chemical properties if you look at this according to the law of octaves. And then, unfortunately, his work was neither accepted by his seniors nor by the Journal of the Chemical Society, which rejected its publication. So his publication got rejected. Octave's theory has got a lot of, so Newland's octave theory also has many limitations. And there are, for instances, elements fitted into the same slot. So he had to fix certain types like cobalt and nickel. Though they have some different properties, but they got one slot in a periodic table, which was not accepted by many of the chemists of that period. And his law and octave theory got, the law was not valid for the element that has the atomic masses higher than calcium. If you can just see that also, those which were having atomic mass more than calcium, up to calcium, he could prove his octave theory. But when after calcium, again, his hypothesis got rejected, and Newland arranged then cobalt, nickel, lead and all in one. And therefore, the law of octaves hold good only for the elements up to calcium. Then when the atomic weight started more than calcium, more than 17, if the atomic weight is like chromium 16, titanium 19, manganese 20, iron 21, copper 23, zinc 24, for this octave rule was not. This table was restricted to only 56 elements and did not leave any room for the new elements. So then he tried to link periodically chemical properties of the elements with the periodicity found in the music. He tried to connect his octave theory. Newland wanted his octave theory with music. He wanted the notes of the music, like you said, Saregama Padanisa. How are these notes again repeats after eight these things? Now also music is connected. We are connecting music with many trying to interlink. As I said, Saregama Padanisa. Again the sa comes repeated, isn't it, in this series? So similarly, he wanted to prove his octaves theory with music. And we in India, we call Saregama Padhanisa, whereas in Western countries, it is Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, this G, A, B, C, D, G. But again, this is how in every musical note, after eighth note, again, it repeats. So octave was trying to link his theory with octave theory with musical notes, and he has worked hard on it to prove. But again, his theory failed. It could not prove for 115 elements. But then came our Mendeleev. Till date, we are following Mendeleev's theory. I wish you people come up with some more inventions and can make a better periodic table even than Mendeleev's, because even Mendeleev's periodic table also has got some limitations. So Mendeleev arranged these elements known at that time in a chart in a systematic order. And what Mendeleev did, till now everybody were trying to arrange elements based upon the atomic weight. And Mendeleev came on with a new hypothesis, where he was trying to arrange his elements according to the atomic number. Sir, class chal raha hai. Thoda der ke baad, please. Half an hour ke baad ji ka. Class mein nalla ke pillu hona hai, complete karna. Check karna hai. Okay. So what happened was this is that he divided the chart into 8 vertical columns and A, B sub rows. So now he has smartly used atomic number as a base, and each column contains elements of similar chemical properties. The elements in the first column, for example, reacts with oxygen to form compounds in channel with a formula called R2O. As we all know, the valency of oxygen is 2. It can combine with 2 elements. So he has used a formula as R2O. Like if it has to, oxygen has to combine with hydrogen, because oxygen has got the combining capacity of oxygen is 2. So H2O, L2O, if it has, it has to find lithium oxide, it has to be L2O, sodium oxide, N2O, potassium oxide, K2O. So he set this general formula for the elements of the first column. And if you see lithium, sodium, and potassium, when it reacts with oxygen, they're found, as I've told you, he said R2O fixes for lithium oxide, sodium oxide, and potassium oxide. Then what happened in the second row? And the second row, he said that the oxygen with combines, it forms a formula. He used a formula as RO. Where is that beryllium, magnesium, calcium, when they react with oxygen, BeO, MgO, and Ca2? Because even beryllium, the combining capacity of beryllium, the valency of beryllium is also 2, oxygen is also 2. And magnesium, so what is happening is it is becoming BeO, MgO, and CaO. CaO, okay. So now, next what happened was we were having... Mendeleev tried to explain the similarities of the elements in the periodic law, and based on Mendeleev's observation regarding the properties of the elements in the periodic table, that is how they were arranged. The law is known as the periodic law of properties of element, and it was proposed as follows. According to Mendeleev's, you know, the law states that physical and chemical properties of the elements are the in the periodic table functions function of their atomic weight. It is based upon the functions of their atomic weight. All the scientists all these times were arranging with the atomic weight. So, but Mendeleev used atomic number to arrange, okay? So that's how he used different techniques, and he could, to a greater extent, prove his hypothesis. So there are 8 vertical columns, and he has divided the groups into 2 subgroups, A and B. And the elements present in groups and its subgroups were having similar properties. So the properties, because the basic reason why they wanted to arrange it, so that it becomes easier for us. Like if we find that aluminium, the same type of metal, the metals that were available, supposing if you could make a utensil with one type of metal, and that means the other metals also can be used, isn't it? So we are able to use variety of metals in this, alkaline metals as well as metals which are subgrouped in A and B. And the entire period that comprises of the entire range of elements with were the properties, they repeat themselves. Their properties keeps repeating, okay? They were same. But predicting the properties of the missing elements, and another Mendeleev's smart move was, what he did is, supposing in between calcium and titanium, he could not find any element with the similar properties. Okay, but accordingly, there should have been, you know, one, some elements in between. So wherever the elements were missing, he kept a gap, so that once we discover, if those elements are discovered, that they can be placed into these gaps. So that is how his hypothesis was could get proofed, and still till today we are using his periodic table. He named these elements tentatively as adding by prefix eka, means one, and of the elements immediately above each empty space. So today we come to know that eka, dukkha, these are all Greek or Latin words, okay, used into it above this empty spaces. So you can just see that atomic weight, density, formula of oxide and formula of chlorides. So these are all used as an empty spaces. Then the next very important is Ekaborium, Eka. So students, I think this much is enough for today. What we will do is we will start SSU up to this, how much you have understood periodic table, Mendeleev's periodic table. And then in your next chapter, we'll start again after your assessments. We'll go for your assessments and see how best you do it. Till then, stay safe, be at home, take care of, all precautions that are necessary precautions. Don't go out without a mask. Take care of yourself and your family members. Enjoy. Happy